Hey guys, welcome to the next session in my Swift beginner course. So in this session, what we are going to learn is error handling, extensions, and then protocols. So as I told you, I'll be keep on doing these tutorials more frequently. So if you want to stay up to date with my future videos, kindly don't forget to hit the subscribe button at the bottom of this video. So let's learn what is error handling. So as the name denotes, it's about handling the errors, right? So at some point of time, there are cases that we might get error from different scenario, and we may need to handle that, like when the user provides invalid input or something like that. So let's jump on to an example. So let's say I'm getting input from the user. Let's say let user input number equal to, and assume that the user has entered 5, okay, and the data type of this one is string, right? Because it is enclosed with double quotation, right? But the value, it actually contains an integer, right? A number it has. So, and I want to convert that string to an integer. So for that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to write a method, func convert string to int, which means we need to give a string to this method, right? So number string, and the data type is string, right? So what we have to do, we need to convert this number string to an integer data type, right? So to do that, let converted number equal to int, to the constructor of int struct we have to pass, like, it, this int has lot of constructor, right? So which one we need? The constructor which takes input as a parameter. If you look at here, this one, it takes a parameter, and then the data type is string. So this is what we needed, right? So, and if you look at the return type of this constructor, it's an optional int, right? You see that question mark here. So which means it, I mean, it is not sure that it is always return a proper integer value. Why? Because I will come for that in a short time. So let's see. So pass that number string to the constructor, right? Now we have the converted number, and we need to return this number to the person whoever calls this method, right? So we need to return this, return converted number. But if we do like that, we will get error, because this method doesn't say that I'm returning a value, right? It just returns. So we need to mark this method's return type. What it will return? Int optional, right? Which means, okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to call this convert string to int method, okay? So let result equal to convert string to int, and pass the user input number to that method, okay? And what I'm going to do, I'm going to print string or value with string data type has been converted to integer data type, and the value is result, right? Okay, so let's run this. Okay, so since I declared this method here and then trying to call here, it was not able to find the method. So I'm going to put this here. See that? You know why we got that error? Because the compiler always tries to go top to bottom approach. So when it tried to find the method here, it was not able to detect the method whether it exists or not, because the method is only declared here, right? So that's the reason for that error. And this is only happens in Swift Playground, because when you go for in real-time projects, like, you won't be having this issue, because everything will be you'll be having inside a class and other stuff. So just so you know. Okay, so it printed 0, right? Because I printed here, so I need to move this to here. So these are all the small mistake we used to do when we learn. So, and this is how you have to debug. So as you can see here, value with string data type converted to the integer value, and it's an optional 5. The reason why it is optional is this method convert string to int returns an optional int, right? So that's the reason why you are having this optional when you try to print the value inside it. So if you don't want that, then what you can do, you can just use if let, so that optional value will be force unwrapped and then optionally binded to this result constant. And then if you print now, let's see what we got. You see that optional has been removed, because it taken the value out of that optional result and then binded it to this one. Okay, right? So this is not error handling, right? This is, I mean, we know this already. So what is error handling? So let's make this method to throw some error if you pass some invalid integer string values. Let's assume that just because this user input number has 5, we didn't face any problem, right? But how about if I am passing like this? It is not an integer, it is a string. So if you try to convert to integer, then you won't get anything. So let's say, see, you got nothing, right? Like else print no successful conversion happened. So let's run that. You see that? Okay, but I don't want this to work in this way, but instead what I need is, in case if I am passing a invalid integer value in a string format, it has to throw some error for me. Okay, so what I'm going to do is, I'm going to mark this method as throws. Okay, and then in case if the conversion of int is not successful, then, okay, if the conversion is successful, which means if we are able to successfully generate an integer data type value from this given number string, then we will be that will be optionally taken out of the resultant integer and then will be stored in this particular constant, right? So in this case we have a proper converted integer value, so we need to return that, right? So let's return it, converted number. If not, if the conversion is failed, then what we have to do, we have to throw error, right? That's what our requirement. So throw error or fatal error with message invalid string given or invalid number string given. So here what I'm going to do is, see, as soon as you mark that method as a throws one, it started to complain you here, call can throw but it is not marked with try. So when you mark a method as a throws, it's as soon as, I mean, wherever you call that method, the compiler will start to complain you that this method might throw some error, so you need to handle that. So these are all the small things which you, the compiler will force you to take care of, so that during when the user uses your application, the chance of crashing of your application is less, right? So how to handle this error then? So to handle that, we have do catch. So in few other technologies they call try catch, right? So try catch block, we used to have that, but in Swift we have do catch. So do what we have to do, and then if it is fails, catch it. So that's the syntax. And then here we need to do this, right? This stuff. So like this, and then this is the line which might throw the error, right? So we need to try that. So try. So when we wrap it inside do catch, so when something goes wrong in this block, it will be automatically catched by this catch block. So I'm going to write something here, print got error and it's handled here, and the description is error dot, or just simply put error. So you might wonder from where this error came. So that's the beauty of Swift. Like as soon as you enter in the catch block, Swift automatically injects with the incoming parameter called error. So here usually other technologies used to have like this, like error like this we used to have in other technologies, right? But in Swift you don't have to put it, right? So you automatically get access to that error instance. Fine then, so let's see how it works now. Okay, so this fatal error abruptly stops your threads. Okay, so instead of this fatal error, I'm going to create an error object called NSError. And for that, I need import foundation. Because this NSError class resides inside this foundation module. Okay, so it is something like importing, like in Java we used to import, in C sharp wherever we used to import namespaces, right? So like that. So and here I am just, this NS error has this constructor domain string to int conversion domain code 101 user info, I'm going to pass it as a nil. I mean, this is like everything, it's up to you. You can pass whatever value you wish to pass it here. So yes, so let's run it now. You see that got error, and it's handled here, and the description is error domain string to conversion domain, the given one, code is 101, and then the description user info is null. Okay, so when it tried to convert the number, it failed, like it throwed some error. So automatically the catch block caught that. Okay, so this is how we used to handle the exceptions. Next one, extensions. So as the name denotes, extension is nothing but adding some extra features to the existing types. That's it, as simple as that. Let's assume that when I say type, we used to declare audio class, video class, or media class, like that, right? So those we call it as types, right? So let's assume that I have a struct string manager, and then it has a method called func print. And it has a value called where name string, or let's say first name, and then where last name, and then the purpose of this method, this print, is to print or print full name, like that.
and then here first name plus one space between the first name and then last name and then last name, right? Okay, so let's go. Let or okay, maybe what I can do here, let's have something meaningful. Student, let's have it in that way. So let student equal to student first name PJ, last name Tech, and then student dot print full name. Let's run that. You see that PJ, this one extra space, this one, and then last name Tech. So we got that. Okay, so in case if we need this concatenation in a different place, then we have to go and write it another time, right? So which is like code duplication. So to avoid that, I'm going to add an extra feature to this student struct. So that's where I'm going to use the extension feature. So extension student, and then I'm going to add a extra method. I'm going to inject, this is something like injecting to the existing class struct enum whatever. So func full name is the method, and it returns a string, and what I'm going to do is return this stuff here. So now instead of doing it on my own, I'm going to call full name. See that? So this is the method, right? So this full name method we can access because we have provided an extension for the student struct. So wherever you have access to the student struct, the object of the student struct, you can access this full name method. Okay, so that's the power of extension. Like you can in one statement, it is something like injecting extra features to the existing type. Like you can inject methods, you can inject like dynamic computed properties, all those stuff. But one thing you cannot do is you cannot have stored properties inside an extension, like something like var marks int or cg or float equal to 500. You cannot have something like this. Extensions must not contain stored properties. Instead, what you can do is you can have it in this way. Let's say that we need to calculate an average of a student. So in that case, what I can do is like return, and provided if you have var total marks equal to int, sorry, float, and then var number of subjects equal to 5, and then here what you can do is averages total marks divided by number of subjects. You can have it in this way. This is also something like injecting yes. So here we need to mark it as a float. So that's it. So that's the power of extension, and that's how you use it, right? So next one is protocols. Protocols, as the name suggests or denotes, it is certain rules, right? Like procedures. So usually protocols will be having a certain defined like declaration of the methods, the properties, etc., but it won't have the implementation of the methods. Like, okay, so when I say it won't have implementation, then where will the implementation will go? So whoever wants to satisfy the protocol, they need to implement the methods or properties. Okay, so assume that we have a protocol called flyable okay, flyable is a protocol, right? And and I'm having a struct called bird, right? And when I say bird, it's a flyable, right? So as I told, we will be using the extension feature, and we will be marking the bird as a flyable. You understand, right? Like we are injecting some extra, like it is not something extra feature in this case. Like not only the bird can fly, right? Even the some machines can fly, right? Like even the flight can fly. So that's the reason why I separated this flyable. So bird is a flyable, and when I say flyable, func number of KMs per hour. Float, right? And when I say that, you see what the compiler does? So you are telling the bird is satisfying the flyable, but you are not implementing the number of KMs per hour, right? So we need to obey that protocol. So let's implement that number of KMs per hour and return like maybe 10.0, something like that. So in this way, in protocols, we only declare the methods or properties, whatever we required, and whoever going to other that protocol, they gonna implement that, whatever the protocol has, whatever the rules defined in the protocols, right? Okay. And let's say I can do like struct machine, and what I can do, extension machine flyable number of KMs per hour, return 700. So that's how we obey the protocol, or we access the protocol, we add that to the protocols. Okay, so I hope you would have liked this video to understand how we need to handle the errors, what is extension, and how to, so the purpose of extension, like provide injecting some extra features to the existing types, and then protocols, like certain defined methods or properties, and whoever going to satisfy the protocol, they gonna have the implementation for the methods or properties, whatever declared in that. Okay, so I hope you have liked this video. So don't forget to hit the subscribe button to stay updated with the future videos. Thank you.